गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। मूविंग टुवर्ड्स द न्यू पॉइंट ऑफ द चैप्टर दैट इज द पोल्ड लूप सिस्टम विच इज कंसिस्टिंग इन द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम इट्सेल्फ। सो वी आर गोइंग टू सी इन डिटेल अबाउट दिस पोल्ड लूप सिस्टम। इन दिस पोल्ड लूप सिस्टम वी आर फर्स्ट गोइंग टू सी समथिंग इन और यू कैन से वी आर गोइंग टू गेट रिवाइज्ड ऑफ द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम एंड देन वी आर गोइंग टू मूव टुवर्ड्स द पोल्ड लूप सिस्टम। So what operating system really does, we already know, just we are going to have an overlook for this operating system. Operating system, what does an operating system really do? Operating system is going to manage the computer system resources. That is nothing but the processor, memory and the input output, etc. So all these things it is going to manage. What operating system is going to do? It is going to manage all the resources like the processor, memory, input output devices and etc. Second thing, it is also going to keep the track for the status and owner of each resource. Okay, so it is going to keep the track which system is going to work currently, which status is going to be in a queue, which application is going to run later on. So all this status is kept by, or all this status is tracked by this operating system. It is also going to decide who gets the resource, okay, which resource is going to work first, the processor, memory, input output, which of it is going to get. So it is also going to decide who gets the resource. Second, it is also going to decide how long the resource can be used. Okay, so what particular time will be given to one particular processor to work on its own. So that is also decided by this operating system. So in this system, that supports the concurrent execution of the programs. So first task, it is going to resolve the conflicts of the resources. Okay, and the second, it is optimizing the performances that is given multiple users. So in the system, it is going to support the concurrent execution. Concurrent execution is nothing but the ongoing program which is executed by the operating system, that is resolved first the conflict. So whatever the time it is going, which kind of interrupt it is going to occur, that conflict is first resolved for the resources. And second, it optimizes the performance given the multiple users. So it is also going to optimize the performance. When this operating system is going to work for multiple users, it is going to optimize the performance of each and every user. So think of it as a keeper of a single copy of a book that everyone in this course needs to read, right? This is just example. Like, remember that there is only one book, but one book is one to be what shared by each and every student. Okay, the keeper is having only one single book, but it has to be read by all the readers. So likewise, this is the operating system. This operating system is going to work for the multiple tasks, but at the same time there are multiple things where this operating system is going to work. So the types of operating systems are the simplest. As I told you, it is the most simplest, where a small kernel on an embedded system is going to work, and most complex, where the full-featured commercial operating system with multi-user security is being provided. Basically, there are two most types of operating systems, where first one is the simplest and second one is the most complex. So simplest is where a small kernel, we have seen what this kernel and rest all things in the last lecture. So this simplest is as the small kernel on the embedded processor, and the most complex is the full featured commercial OS, that is the multi-user security. So with multi-user security, it is also going to have the graphics support. We have seen that with the GUI, graphic user interface. So the next, it is also going to have a support for the networking purpose. And third, it is going to have the support for the peripheral communication. Now peripheral communication is nothing but the input output communication is done with help of this operating systems. And the next is the concurrent executions of the programs. So here we can see the operating system hierarchy. So this is the program application where each and every program is going to run, and this is the outer shell with the OS. Then this is the file and disk support, the OS kernel and hardware. So finally this application program is going to interfaced with the hardware with the help of these supports. So these are going to work as the bus, these are going to work as the interface between the application and the hardware. So next we are going to see is the tasks and functions. So in this tasks and functions, we are here, we can know this is C. So what is the task and function of the OS we are going to look? Okay, so here you can see there is the while. We are going to write a program, suppose, then there is a while bracket, get data and process data, then complete the bracket. So what this block is explaining us that unless and until you are going to get this data one, this is going to be in a loop for continuous period. Once the data, whatever the data you want, it has been achieved, then you are going to get out of this loop. Okay, so this is nothing but a task. This is one task. For example, suppose you want to one jump from one place to another. So jumping from one place to another is a task. Okay, so unless and until you reach that particular goal, you're going to continuously jump. Okay, for example, I'll give you, whenever you're going to do the skipping, okay, suppose my target is 30 skips I want to do. Okay, so 30 skips is a task. Okay, so unless and until I am going to reach to that 30 task of that 30 skippings, I am continuously being jumping while I'm been roping, right? So I'll be in a loop. So that is nothing but the loop, and 30 skippings is the task. So this is the thing. Okay, and while doing the skipping, what you need? You need a rope and you need a human being. Okay, so human being and the rope is the functions, is it not? Similarly, here also, to get this data processed, this is get data and process data are the functions. Okay, while this is due to process the data is a task, and to get the data continuously unless you are going to reach the target is nothing but a loop. Hope so you have understood what is loop, task and function. Okay, so what it is here, a task is a process that repeats itself. Okay, so a task is a process where it is going to repeat continuously in the loop forever. Obviously, unless and until I am going to achieve my task, I am going to be in a loop continuously and forever. So essential building blocks of the real-time software systems. So there are some essential blocks where you need to build the software systems, where you need to build in a continuously be in the loop unless and until you are going to get that target. And the next is a function. So what is a function? The function is nothing but produced, that is called. Okay, the function. Now I'm going to call a function. Whenever I'm going to call a function, now get data, I have called that function, is it not? After getting the data, what I need to do? I need to process on that data. Okay, so getting the data and processing the data is nothing but the functions which I'm going to call. So this function is going to, it runs and then exit and may return a value, is it not? So first get data is going to run. Unless and until you are going to get the data processed, it is going to be in a loop. And once the process has been over, whenever you are going to get one particular number or you are going to return some value, it is going to stop. Okay, for example, here I have told you to process the data, right? So to process the data, what I need to do? Integer, add two numbers, okay, int x and int y. While I am adding these two numbers x and y, for example, suppose 2 plus 5, whenever I am going to add this number 2 plus 5, I am returning some value 7, is it not? So whenever I am returning this value 7, I am going to stop my function. Okay, so this is nothing but a task and second one is the function. Hope so you have understood. Now second is the operating systems. In this most cases, the RTOS. What is RTOS? RTOS is nothing but the real-time operating system, which is nothing but equal to the operating system of the kernel. Okay, in this, an embedded system is designed for a single purpose, so the user shell and the file disk access features are unnecessary. So we know, what is embedded system? again and again we are going to repeat the same definition of embedded system, that is nothing but the combination of hardware and software. Okay, so that embedded system is been designed for one particular task. It is designed for some particular function. So that embedded system is going to be designed only for a single purpose. So the user shell, whoever it is going to use, the user shell and the disk or the file, it is going to have access only for that particular features. Okay. Now second thing, the RTOS gives you the control over your resources. So this RTOS, whatever we are going to use, that is the real-time operating system, it is going to give access to the own resources where no background process, there should be no any multitasking purpose going on, and just happens. Okay, so bounded number of tasks. So suppose, what is the task the embedded system is going to run only for a specific function? Suppose the OS has been running for some over, or it is going to have the control for some other resources. It just happens, then that it has to, should be given some bounded tasks. Okay, and third, the operating system, it is going to give you the control over the timing by allowing. By allowing means, suppose there are some 4 to 5 multitasking programs are going on. So these 4 to 5 multitasking programs has to be given some priorities. Now priorities is depending upon which task is most important to you all for that particular time. It has to be decided. So that particular task is been given some priorities, and likewise it has been manipulated for that task priorities. Okay, and second is choice by scheduling the options. What you can do is, first thing what you can do is set some priorities to each and every task, that according to the main function you can set the priorities. And second thing is by the choice. Now that choice, now suppose I thought, you know, this function has to be worked first, that function has to be worked later on. So depending upon the choice, you can either set the task priorities or by setting the main priorities by giving some number of bounded, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, like you guys set the priorities and accordingly that task will continuously running on. So this OS kernel function has main 3 functions. First one is the task scheduler, second one is the task dispatcher, and the third one is the inter-task communication. Now this first one, let us see the task scheduler. This task scheduler is to determine which task will run in next in a multitasking system. Okay, task scheduler. Now scheduler means we know we are going to schedule. Likewise, we know in a time we are going to prepare one timetable, right? After that, what we are doing in the timetable is like, after one task we are going to take the second task. So we are preparing the timetable so that after one task we are going to finish the second, then we are going to finish the third. Likewise, if there are 5 to 6 multitasking programs running on simultaneously, then we need to determine which task will run next. Okay, as we have decided further, we need to set the priorities in the multitasking system. Second, once it has been the task scheduler, next we are going to see is the task dispatcher. Now in this task dispatcher means what? To perform the necessary bookkeeping to ask a task. Okay, so now third is the inter-task communication. Now this inter-task communication is nothing but to support the communication between one process. Now support the communication between one process is nothing but a task and another. So you need to communicate, you need to support from one task to another task. So while communicating between these two tasks, you need to, you are going to inter-task the communication. Okay, so these are the 3 main functions of the OS. First one is the task scheduler, second one is the task dispatcher, and the third one is the inter-task communication. Next, we are going to see for the types of RTOS. The real-time kernel design strategies. So in this type of RTOS, we are going to see the real-time kernel designs. First one is the polled loop systems, second one is the interrupt-driven systems, third one is the multitasking, fourth one is the
foreground or background systems, and the next is the full featured RTOS. So in detail we are going to see the first one, that is the polled loop system. Before going in detail to this polled loop systems, we are going to see what exactly means the things polling. Okay, so here we are going to see what is the polling. Polled loop systems. So the polling or the polled operation in a computer science refers to actively sampling the status of an external device by client program as a synchronous activity. So what it is called? Polling or polled operation. What you may call it as a polling or you may call it as a polled operation. In a computer science, actually it refers actively that sampling the status of an external device, okay, by a client's program as a synchronous activity. So hand in hand, the external device who is going to work, or it is when it is going to get an interfaced with a client program, it should go hand in hand. Okay, so this is nothing but called as the polling. So polling is most often used in terms of an input output devices, and it is also referred as polled input output, or it is called as a software driven input output. Okay, so let us see. Now here, what do you mean by external devices? Now external devices are the peripherals, or the peripheral devices is an accelerated device used to put information into and get information out of the computer. Okay, so as we told, external devices are nothing but the peripherals. Likewise, suppose they're the USB, the pen drives, the cables, whatever you are going to use for the interfacing purpose, for the input and output, it is nothing but called as the peripherals. So there are several categories of the peripheral devices may be identified based on the relationship with the computer. Obviously, whenever you want to take the information from the computer, or whenever you need to give the information to the computer, then there are some several categories of the peripheral devices which may be identified and based on the relationship of the computer. So first we need is the input devices are like sends the data or the instruction to the computer, such as mouse, keyboards, graphic tables, image scanner, barcode reader, game controller, light pen, light gun, microphone, digital camera, webcam, dance pad, and read only memory. So these are the input devices whichever they are going to send the signals to the computer. And the output device. Now the output devices is like from the computer you are going to take the information from the computer, like the monitor, projector, printer, headphones, computer speakers, and likewise these are the output devices. And the input output device, both whenever they are going to perform input and the output function, such as the computer data storage like the disk drive, as I told you, the disk drive, USB flash drive, memory card and tape drive, etc. So there are many modern electronic devices such as internet enabled devices and digital watches, keyboards, tablet computers have interfaces for the use of computer and peripheral devices. So let us see what you mean by client. Now first we have seen the word client is that is like the client is a piece of a computer, a hardware or a software that access a service made available by server. Now what is a client? Let us see what is client. A client is nothing but a piece of a hardware or a software that access the service made available by server. So here you can see in the diagram is that this is the server. This server wants to communicate to this PCs, or if they want to communicate with the mobile. So what is the via it is going to communicate? The server is going to communicate with these devices is by the internet. Okay, so when the server wants to communicate with this hardware device, or it may be the software device, this is a piece of computer that is made available for the access for the server and the computer. So the server is often but not always an another computer system in which the case the client accesses the service by way of a network. And now we are going to see the polling. So the polling is a process where a computer or a controlling device waits for an external device to check its readiness. First, what we need to do, whenever we are going to connect some systems for an external device to the computer, what we actually do, it is also going to flash a message like the USB has been connected. Okay, so we are going to wait whether the access has been ready or not. So once the access is ready, often with a low level hardware, you're going to check whether the external device to check for its readiness or whether it is in a ready state for often with a low level hardware. Now for example, here you can see whenever you need to connect a printer, okay, via a parallel port. So what it is going to do, the computer is going to wait until a printer has received the next character. Means what we do, whenever we are going to connect the printer to the PC, first we need to check the access, whether it is compatible or no. If it is compatible, the printer icon has to be displayed on the PC with the device and printer's function. Okay, so this, once that has been received, it is going to wait for the next character. So this process can be a minute as only by reading one bit. This is sometimes used synonymously with busy wait polling. So continuously, if it has been not detected, then it is going to show the busy and wait polling. Sometimes it is going to show. So in this situation, what you are going to do? So in this situation, when an input-output operation is required, the computer does nothing rather than check the status of the input-output device until it is ready, and at which point the device is going to get access. What we can do, if it is going to show you the busy tone all the time, what you can do, for example, suppose if you are going to call one particular number and it is going to be showing you all the continuously the busy tone, what you can do in that case, you can wait until you get access to that particular call. Is it not? Similarly, here also, in this situation also, whenever you are going to get the busy wait operation or busy wait function from the printer, in this operation, what you actually can do is, the computer does nothing, but it has to check the status continuously if the input-output device is ready or not to access that particular printer. In other words, is nothing but the computer waits until the device is ready. Okay, so the polling also refers to the situation where a device is repeatedly checked for readiness. What it is going to do? The polling also refers to the situation where a device is repeatedly checked for readiness, and if it is not, then the computer returns to the different task. What you can do? The polling, it is refers to the situation when the device is repeatedly checked for the readiness, and then also if it is not allowed, then what the computer does, it is going to check for the different task of the system. So although not as a wasteful of CPU cycles as busy waiting, this is generally not an efficient as an alternative to polling or the interrupt driven input output. So here what you can say, this is not a wasteful of the CPU, okay, busy waiting. So this generally is not efficient as the alternative to the polling. In simple single purpose system, even a busy wait is perfectly appropriate if no action is possible until the input output access. But moreover, what you can do is, often that was not traditionally as consequences of a simple hardware or non-multitasking operating system. So polling is often intimately involved in a very low level hardware. Why? Because compulsorily a single purpose system has to wait unless and until it is showing you the busy wait, and this busy wait operation is perfectly appropriate. That is also correct, it has to show that busy wait until when, if no action is possible for that input-output access. So the polling is oftenly intimately involved for a very low level hardware. For example, A polling a parallel printer port to check whether it is ready or for another character involves examining as little as 1 bit of a byte. So every time when the printer is been connected to the PC, the computer needs to check whether that printer is ready or not. So every time it is going to check for the next bit from one particular byte. Okay, so this bit represents that the time of a reading whether a single wire in of the printer cable is low or high voltage. Whenever you want to check the one bit character continuously, that time the reader or the printer is going to check for the cable whether it is showing the low level voltage or high voltage. So likewise, this polling is going to occur in between the input output devices or the external devices. So let us see the algorithm how the polling is going to occur. So polling can be described in the following steps. First one is the host action. The host is going to repeatedly check the busy bit, okay, of the controller until it becomes the clear. What the host can do, as I given there the example of the phone calling also. Whenever you want to call one particular number and continuously if it is showing you the busy tone, what you can do? Unless and until you are going to get the line clear, unless and until the person who is going to whom you are going to call is going to keep or end the call, you are not going to get the line clear, is it not? Similarly here also, the host is going to check repeatedly for the busy bit of the controller until it is going to become clear. So once the line is clear, the host writes in a command register and writes a byte into the data out register. So once it is get clear, then the host is going to write the command register and into the host register. So the host is then set the command ready bit. Set the command ready bit means it is going to send one signal set to 1. So that now the device can compatibly work with the external device and the computer. Now what is the controller action? So when it is the controller senses the command ready bit, it is set to set the busy bit. Okay, so the controller reads the command register continuously, and since the write bit is set, it performs the necessary input output operation on the device. So once it has been writing operation is been given, so what particular writing is been given, it is going to set one particular task. And if the read bit has been sent instead of write, then the device is loaded into that particular register. Once it has been write means the register is to given the command to the register to write operation. But once it is the ready bit is sent, means you need to load some data into that register. Okay, so which is further read by the host over there. So the controller clears the command ready bit once everything is over. So it clears the error bit to show successful operation and reset the busy bit to 0. So once the read and write operation is completely over, then what the controller is going to do? The controller is going to send the clear command, or it is going to clear the command ready bit once everything is over, and the clear error bit to show that the successful operation has been carried out. And then it is going to send the ready bit busy is equal to 0. So next we are going to see is the polled loops now. Now we are going to come back to the main point is the polled loop. So far now we have seen what do you mean by polling and what are the different types and how the polling is going to occur with the example of the printer and computer. Now here we are going to see is the polled loops. The simplest is the RT kernel. RTOS kernel is the simplest of the polled loops. So a single and the repetitive instructions that need to test a flag that indicates whether or not the event has occurred. Okay, so whenever you are going to test the bit continuously, the flag has been set to check whether the indicated is given or no, whether it has to the device is ready or no. Okay, so no task communication or scheduling is needed, only a single task is going to exit. So whenever you are going to perform such kind of operation, there is no need for any inter-task communication or scheduling is needed for this kind of things. So next we are going to see is the excellent for handling high speed data channels. So these polled loops are also excellent for handling the high speed data channels, especially when event occur widely spaced intervals and when the processor is dedicated to handle only one channel at a time. For example, you can see this is the polled loop example. Okay, so this polled loop example is where you are going to identification of friend or foe. Okay, this is the system of the software which is going to communicate with the central RRM processor in the aircraft cockpit. Okay, if a contact is made whenever you are going to in an aircraft, whenever you need to communicate with the central RRM processor, and when a contact is made, the flag called IFF. IFF is nothing but identification friend or foe. That is IFF data here. This flag is set by the network and the alarm process is going to process the data. So when it is going to do, while it is true, whenever you want the condition is true, what you can do, while condition is true, infinite loop do forever. Okay, we have seen what is task, loop and function. So whenever you want to get the task, while task true, if IFF data here is equal to true, then if the task is always equal to true condition, then you need to check for IFF data. Okay, if not, suppose the data is not true, then what you are going to do, you are going to process the data, you are going to call for the data functions. Okay, continuously you are going to call for the data functions, and after calling the data functions, if the status is false, then again you need to go back into the IFF data until it is going to become true. So this is the continuously polled loop example, where it is going to be in a loop unless and until you are going to get the flag. And if it is going to show you the false, then reset the flag. Okay. So here is an extension of the polled loop example. Int contact, int get IFF data, voice sound alarm, voice guard log contact, int red is equal to 1, int blue color is equal to 2. Now see, red, whenever there is blue, you need to show 2, whenever it is red, you need to get 1. Okay, so while is it to 1, while 1 means you need to see that red is equal to 1, so that the contact get information, IFF data. Now what you need to do is, you need to get the information from the software IFF, you need to switch the contact. So in case suppose it is going to show you the red, so what you need to do, when it is going to show you the color red, means you need to show the sound alarm for the cockpit. Okay, in the same case, if it is going to show you the blue color, then the put the contact data into the memory and break. Okay, end the switch and end the infinite loop. So this is the loop. Unless and until you are going to get the sound alarm or the contact into the memory, you want to be in a loop continuously unless and until the contact or the alarm is been given out. So here we are going to see the polled loops pros and cons. That is nothing but the advantages and disadvantages of the polled loops. So the pros are nothing but the simple to write and debug. Okay, the advantages of polled loops are nothing but it is simple and easy to write and debug, and it is also have the response time, and response time is easy to determine. But the disadvantages is that this polled loop systems can fail due to burst of events. When there are continuously the events are going on, then these kinds of polled loops are generally going to fail. Next is, generally these polled loops are not sufficient to handle the complex systems. As I told you all, when there are multiple systems are going on, and if the RTOS, we know operating systems are of two types, simplest and the complex one. When you are going to run under the complex one, the polled loops are not going to support. And the third is the waste of the CPU time, especially when the event begin polled occur.